Yeah, I took the blood right last time.
Okay, but it's good to have you. Thank you for being with us today. We've got three or four items just to talk about here at the work session. What we've got listed, and then there might be some other things to cover in the process. So it is good to see you. Finance, you want to talk about the institute and the end service?
I do, but I also, before I get started here, we've got a sign back here. I know you all have noticed. Had a couple of our employees, a couple of gentlemen that worked really hard on this. Mr. Ben Johnson at Geraldine, who's the agribusiness teacher, he has a machine that he cuts out all this stuff. And they were doing some metal work one day and preparing some things. And I don't know, somehow the conversation got out that we'd like to have some lettering up here. And I asked him if that was something that they could do. And he said, well, I think we're pretty, we'll send you up. So I send the logo, visual file, and next thing I know, it was just a few minutes, he sent me this little emblem right here. It was really nice, and so we got to talk about it. And he called Joey Hayman, who's the ag teacher at Sylvania, who has some experience with woodwork and welding and different things. And so they worked together on this and put this together. They painted it, welded it, pieced it together, and came in here and hung it up for us. So I want to thank them for their hard work on that. They did a really good job of that. I'm proud of that. And our students were involved in it too. And on the days that they were cutting it out, loving it, doing this stuff, the students at both drove in. They kind of worked on the metal part and all that. And the kids at Sylvania worked on some of the woodwork. So it's kind of a collaborative program between those two programs here. And so I'm glad to have that. We could have bought something or did something to put up here, but I think it means more to have our students manufacture and create something to hang up here. So I was excited about that, and I would recognize them for their work, so I'm excited about that.
That's good.
Got a few things coming up as we get ready to start this school year. We're starting to work on our, we're working on our institute, and we're not finalized, our Institute of Professional Development Days. We're going to do things a little bit differently this year, gentlemen. In the years past, we've had it at the Lyceum over Northeast, which is a wonderful place. And Northeast has graciously allowed us to use their facility. It was a beautiful place. However, over the last couple of years, we've kind of noticed some problems with that. All of our employees, all of our employees aren't able to attend in that location. It's just not large enough. And then over the last few years, even our certified or teachers and administrators haven't really been able to comfortably fit in there. They've been sitting and standing up in the back and stuff. And it was important to me in the conversations we had was to get all of our employees, and obviously some career techs will get some trainings, and there's not everybody, but we wanted to invite everybody to be a part of that institute program. It's going to be from around 8 to 10:30 or something like that. We're working on some final draft, and we'll get that out real soon. But it was important for me to be able to invite all of our school employees to participate in that day. We've got an inspirational speaker, Mark Brown. I think many of y'all have heard him before. He spoke at some school board conferences. He's going to come and deliver a keynote for us. I'm going to present a few goals and things that we're going to be doing, but I'm excited about that day. We'll be at the DeKalb County Schools Coliseum. I've already spoken with Will. We're working on that. We do that on Tuesday. The FTC meeting is on that Saturday, so they already kind of have things set up. That is going to be the 1st of August. And I'll be giving you a finalized agenda once you do it. I'm going to say we're 85% there. We just have to nail down a couple of sessions. And the way we're going to set it up is on the 1st, we're going to have our institute, and then we're going to have two breakout sessions for professional development. We modified our calendar this year. We've got a 177 school days, and we've got that cut down, so we're going to have some extra work days. But we're going to do on the 1st, we're going to have institute followed by PD sessions, two breakout sessions, and every teacher, everybody's going to be involved in those that afternoon. After that, we'll have breakout session one followed by lunch, and then another breakout session on August the 2nd. There'll be some specific PDs for specific content here, whether it be EL, special ed, different folks like that. Bus drivers will have training on the 3rd. So we've got some things going on that week, but it's going to allow us to try to put all of our stuff together, put it together. a good model. Most teachers are gonna be assigned one session to the other session, and only pretty much an interest or professional learning goal there, so they'll have some selection, some choices there. And we're working on getting those set up in STIPD where they can go ahead and pre-register, so they know who's coming and prepare themselves. So I'm excited about that. I think that's gonna be a good way of doing it. And in your packet here, I've got kind of a pre-draft of where we are in some of the programs that we have. So it ranges from academic to counseling to digital curriculum, instruction, gift and special ed, all kinds of things. So we're gonna have some things for everyone, and I think it's gonna be, I'm optimistic that it's gonna be really good.
Where's the bus drivers?
Bus drivers, where's their pay gonna be? It's gonna be, that's Coliseum.
Eight to twelve, everyone's invited, we'll have a meal. Board members are invited.
8 to 12 on the 3rd, at the Coliseum.
Okay, the new teacher orientation's on the 31st.
Yeah, new teacher orientation's on the 31st, that'll start at 8 o'clock. We're really excited about that. We've got a group of new teachers and new employees. And when we do that, we obviously during the summer, we hire a lot of teachers, and so we invite those. But we also invite teachers who may have been hired to go back during Christmas, for the second semester. So that'll be here as well, a good opportunity. Our supervisors, we schedule it where it's on a standalone day, where we're not gonna have as many other activities going on, so that all of our supervisors can come and introduce themselves, put a face, a name and a face together for our new employees, so they know if I'm working on a purchase order, this is who I'm talking to, this is who I'm working for. If I'm, working on some PD and working on certificate renewal, here's who I'm talking with. Special education referral, and here's who I'm talking with, those kind of things. Just basically letting our new employees know who we are. So I'll be with that. That is on the last day of July.
This room?
Yes, it's gonna be right here in this room.
On the job postings where it says like 2017-44, is that just in 2017, or is that the school year going back to the office?
That's from January 1, 2017.
So we're gonna hire, we're up to 82 at least, probably what we're gonna do tonight. So that tells you how many people.
And some of those will be transferred.
Right.
But then they backfill with somebody
else.
Sure.
Sure.
So you're looking at a lot of employees.
Yeah. Okay. Good.
Any other questions regarding the institute or potential orientation? I'm excited about that. Next item here on our work session, SRUA training. We have partnered with Marshall County to work on a grant through the Southern Regional Education Board, SRUA. And they have multiple levels and different things often. But the state has piloted a college readiness course, and that's kind of where a lot of people's minds start going to. And people kind of think of that. But it's really, that's a component of it. It also has a high school readiness, which is more of a middle school program where it instructs challenges in direct strategies in our instruction, how we engage students, how we activate prior knowledge, how we inform our students, how we create compelling arguments in our writing and our constructs. They create, there's two components of it, really. LDC, which is literacy, and MDC, which is math. And so you're obviously, literacy is taught across all content areas. We try to go away from it, but sometimes you get to think about literacy. Well, literacy is taught in English and in reading. Well, it is, but it should also be taught in math and science and in history. And this is a construct that I believe and I hope is going to allow us to expand that. Of course, the math, while, the literacy part is in math, also math really works, math and science really work here. So we've got a grant with Marshall County. Our system itself wasn't necessarily large enough to work on that. Marshall, so we kind of worked together, Dr. Philip Cleveland, who was an interim state superintendent, he helped work with that. So we've got some teachers right now up in Nashville that are working on some training to bring back to our county. We're going to be following up with that. They're getting some orientation, kind of learning a little bit about it. I wrote up there yesterday. I went into the office and worked for a little bit, and I wrote up to Ider and met with Mr. Lyles, who's joined us, back in the principal at Ider High School. I know y'all probably met him. Glad to have him here with us. He's doing a really good job up there, getting off the ground and everything. Talk talked with him for a few hours, and then I went on with Nashville, they were changing and how to, you know, support it, run a little bit more myself, it was really good, and I'm gonna be excited about what they're here, so I'm optimistic about that. Any questions about that? Next item is one that we probably talked about for a long, long time, is basically testing update. We talked a long time about it, we gotta have it in the answer, you know, just gonna be honest with you. Testing update with Alabama State Department of Education. As you know, it's been publicly broadcast in the media, the State Board of Education decided to remove the ACTS bar as our standardized assessment for accountability.
How long have we had that?
4 years, we had it for 4 years, it replaced the ARM Plus, which replaced the ARM, which took the place of the SAT. So, you know, we've had several, we're going to be in a time of transition. The state has been also purchasing and providing a tool called Global Scholar, is what it was initially referred to, and that's kind of what most people still call it, education service. But Scantron, who owns it now, they're the technical name. So for the upcoming year, we're going to be using Scantron or Global Scholar as our accountability tool for grades 3 through 8. Now Aspire was using 3 through 8 and grades 10, but today the State Department of Education in a work session has decided what they're going to do. Now of course this is subject to change, I'm sure. But they are going to grade grades 3 through 8, we're going to use Scantron and Global Scholar. And in grade 11, not grade 10, grade 10 accountability is no longer going to be accountability grade 4. So it's going to move to grade 11, which we're going to be using the ACTS, just the ACT, college ACT, which we already administer in our schools, so that's probably what that is. Now, when we look at accountability and how Scantron is going to inform or how they're going to evaluate it to a summit assessment, I don't know exactly all the answers out there. Scantron is really designed to be a formative assessment, which means that you give it 3 times a year, and once you receive the results to it, you look at it, you evaluate your results, you evaluate where your students perform, and you make instructional decisions based on that information. I've got these students that are weak in this area, I've already covered it, so but they're still weak in it, maybe I need to go back and, you know, circle back on that, or I've got this group that's not proficient in this area, I need to do some intensive instruction or remediation with this group. And that's kind of how it's being used, or that's how it's designed to be used. It's not necessarily designed to be a summative assessment, so I'm sure we'll be getting some more information about that. It's, you know, it's also kind of a, you know, the better you do on it, the more challenging. It's computer adaptive, that's the term they use for basically when you start answering questions correctly, it's going to throw you, if I answer this question correctly, it's going to throw me a hard one. If I answer it correctly, it's going to get harder. If I start missing it, it's going to kind of bounce back. Or at least at some point in time, it's going to kind of level out and say, well, here's where you are. You know, so I don't know exactly how that will pan out or what information we'll get. I know that I've been told we'll have some information fairly soon. I spoke to Jeff Langham, who's a deputy superintendent for the State Department, and he said we'll be getting some information soon. What soon is, I'm not sure. But we got to get it pretty soon. In one other note,
we will if they will be done at the same time.
Yeah, we'll get it 3 times a year. We'll get it 3 times a year, a fall window, a winter window, and a spring window. I'm assuming that will not change for all information I've got, says that will stay the same. One other assessment that the board looked at, I'm not certain if they've adopted it yet, but they discussed the PSAT, which is pretty widely accepted, especially out west and in some northern areas, northern states, was the PSAT. And the discussion was to administer it in the fall of the year for the 11th grade, and then the ACT in the spring of the year, which will be our accountability. Now, I'm not certain, but we've not given that PSAT in Alabama except on a very limited basis. Some affluent districts have chosen to give it, pay for it out of local funds, but we haven't here. We offered it at Collinsville, we offered it to some kids that they chose to take, we would set up some times for. I'm going to have to study it in the ACT and see what kind of alignments there are and what kind of difference.
Is there a good comparison?
Well, that's what
the scoring is different.
Oh, it's going to be much different, yeah, because you've got a lot. Yeah, the scoring is completely different.
Yeah.
Now, the content of it and the standards that are evaluated on it, that's an area that I'm going to have to quite frankly dig into a little bit, and I'm sure some of this across the state will. And I'll be working on some of those. there's throughout that, they're both supposed to help determine, you know, some college readiness and preparedness, so there's going to definitely be some, you know, some correlations and some commonalities, so we just have to identify those. Any questions regarding, and Global Scholar or Scantron is only going to be used for 1 year. It's designed to be a bridge from 16-17 with the Aspire to 18-19 when the state has adopted a new standardized assessment. So we've got this 1 year window here that we're going to use Global Scholar. It's designed to get us to that next state adopted assessment. At this point in time, I have no idea what it will be, but I do know that there's approximately 8 or 9 providers that are buying, you know, for that. I don't even know who those 8 or 9 people are, but I'm certain that some of them are already pre-established. Vendors Park is one that a lot of states use, and there's others out there. But then there's also a push for the state to develop their own, our own, standardized assessment. So I don't know how that'll pan out, but that's just kind of, I want to keep you guys updated abreast of what information I have as we have in the public on that as well. So that's just where we are today. So as I learn more, I'll definitely keep you all updated best I can with the information I've got. Any other questions?
What would be the benefit of us developing our own assessment?
In certain states, they develop a test and they roll it off every year. So, example, you know, you may have the, let's say the Alabama assessment version 1.0. So it's given this year. Well, once it expires, instead of turning that test in, you keep the test. The school keeps the test and they use it to have informed instruction, guide instruction. Once I get those results back, I look at students who are real strong in this area. Hey, but all students did real poorly in, you know, geometric figures or whatever. And so they go back and they use that test. Well, why did we miss these questions? What happened here? What was the problem? And they can use it as an instructional tool to reinforce that. And the next year, it's not the same test as a, you know, version 2.0 or whatever. Maybe it just keeps going like that. Some states implement their state testing in the following year. They implement it somewhere around, October 1, and they go ahead and do it then. That way, they've been in school for a couple months, and you've got the rest of the year. If they do that, then you've got the rest of the year to find out where they scored poorly at, where you improve it. Once again, that comes with getting the scores returns very quickly. You got to get those back real quick. So I think the biggest benefit of being in the state is you kind of, you know, get to control some of those decisions. It's just more local control over your education decisions. But what's best, you talk to a dozen people, you get the best answers. I can see Mary on multiple avenues. But that's some of the conversations that are taking place. Earlier this week, we met with a group, some of you guys were able to join the couple, with Schneider Electric. They come in, and there's another group that's also come in and has sat down and is working on a proposal to us. When we come into office, we wanted to evaluate a lot of different things, one being electric consumption usage. We spend our utilities well over $2 million on an annual basis, well over. So obviously, for every local dollar we spend on bikes and utilities, is something that we can't pull back to the classroom. So we wanted to make sure that we had some ways to leverage our money in a more efficient way. And so I spoke to Schneider, another company, and Resco, and asked them to kind of come up with a legal proposal for us. What they've done, a lot we can do. So they poured through our Mr. Cooper, he's been a pivotal part of this. He's helped gather a lot of this information, been a lot of these conversations. They helped gather our utility bills, the electric cooperatives, and other agencies. And they presented a small proposal. other companies there in a unique position because they offer professional services. And so they kind of have some ways where they're required by law to at least on the surface present a budget neutral plan where that they propose it and they help get the funding for it and they help do all this stuff. It is guaranteed that we'll not spend 1 cent more than what, but they're guaranteeing that if there is a difference that they don't have the return on what they say, that they are required by law, and it's in the Alabama Administrative Code, they're required to write a check to us to make up that difference. And of course, a company can stay in business very long if they're writing checks, so they're going to come up with a model that's beneficial. I like what they have to say. I like the other folks as well. So the other people are supposed to come at some point in time and talk with them. Very concerned to talk a little bit about some of their proposals. But this is something that we're looking at. You know, we've got, from my understanding, Mr. Bus can correct me, I believe that we've got about 300 air conditioning units that are about 20 plus years old. Having to maintain those is costly. They operate, their efficiency, first of all, is not nearly what it needs to be. Repairs on that, finding repair parts, maintaining the freon levels of them and stuff like that, how they're cool, coolants they're doing. You know, those are things that we're going to have to look at, have to be repairing in the next few years. So there's going to be some expenditures that are already going to be in place. Some of our lighting, over, automating some of our, you know, systems and thermostats to control when they're on, when they're off. You know, we want to make sure that we have a very comfortable school and a very school that's comfortably cool and warm when it's supposed to be or whatever. But, you know, being a little bit more efficient with it helps. There's several companies that both, several districts that both of these companies have worked with, and they have both have really good references and really good reputation. So I'm looking forward to learning a little bit more about this. Some point in time, I hope to maybe present, you know, a recommendation to you guys to proceed with one of these plans. And that would develop a very specific, detailed plan with what we expect us to say, what they guarantee, and this is guaranteed.
What we heard of that.
Well, you know, obviously, you know, they develop a plan. They have subcontractors that work underneath them, and you know, they develop. You know, there's some costs built into them. I don't know exactly what their model is. They also work finding rebates and other governmental incentives that allow them to do this kind of work. So they're, you know, obviously they've got to make.
It's very detailed.
Yeah. Oh, it is extremely. Yeah. But there's a couple folks that do this, and both are really highly thought of. Background information I've received. So I think it's a win-win. I mean, you're guaranteed it's not going to cost you. It's guaranteed by law to be budget neutral. So it's something we're looking at because it's important. It's important if we can return some of these dollars that we're putting on a light bill to the classroom, then we need to do it.
Yeah.
If we can return to the students and to, you know, whatever, then it's all good. I'm excited to hear a little bit more about that. That's kind of what I had for our work session.
I was going to ask Mr. Peppers. I know you and I talked, and you had a question or two about the proposal thing. Did we get those? Did we get those answered?
No, I can't remember the couple of things that me and you had talked about now, but
yeah, I think one question was at what point.
How far
to cross the commitment line?
I know we talked about it might be December, it might be later on, but you know, at what point do we get too far into it where we don't turn back? Can we go to phase two or phase three?
Basically, when we decide to engage in them doing we kind of decide what we want the parameters to be. If we decide we know that we've got these units, central units that are 300 of them, 20 years old. Without doubt, we know those are going to. So we can kind of focus, hey, we need, this is one area that we want to prioritize, or, you know, new HVAC, some automation, some new roofs, or whatever we decide what areas that we need to do. These are areas of priority. The ceiling, you know, maybe in some of our buildings we got single pane windows. Well, that's not, we know that's not your chief issue. So if we decide, hey, here's a building that's all these windows are single pane, we need to, you know, we get to decide those. And once we decide to do that, we gotta tell them what the parameters are. And that, we kinda enter into a contract to, for them to really develop a specific action plan. They'll come back to us within those parameters and say, this is what we, it's gonna cost you. This is what we believe we can save you. Here's.
They can give us a long list of these are the things you need to do. We can say, well, we'd like to do these.
Sure. In fact, I'll kinda send a demo of what they do. They'll put it on the board and they'll on digital, you know. And they'll put it up here and they'll have numbers and you'll say, I don't think we need to do that. And they'll hit a button and it's off the screen and it retabulates everything. So we kind of decide to agree to that. And then once they put, once we develop that specific capital plan that we want to go with, and they put their guarantees in place, we put our order, that's when you actually.
I like that idea, whether it's them or another county or whatever, you know, it's a no loss for us, you know, I like that.
These are guaranteed, you know, by law to be a budget. And that's why, you know, that's why you've got all these districts back here that, you know, that are, you know, that's why all of these folks, you know, have chosen.
And I think that, if I understand right, that's why it doesn't have to go through a bid process.
Right.
Is because it is budget neutral.
It's considered to be a professional service, much like an architect, a board attorney, because it's, this is a little, it's different, but it's kind of like that. It's guaranteed to be budget neutral by law, so it's not gonna cost us.
Next, at their next work session, we're gonna have at least one system planner do a presentation. We may have a separate one, and I'm gonna get them lined up with this meeting. So I'm kinda excited about that. If we get two system planners, that will take up probably most of the work session next time. So put that on your calendar, make sure you're there. One thing you said earlier about the SREB stuff, I'm excited that we're partnering with a neighboring system. I think that makes us better, and it brings some more things to the table that we can do. So I'm excited about those kind of items.
Well, I think, you know, we all have expertise in areas of strengths and weaknesses, and I think when we can be, you know, collaborative in our efforts and work together on the process and use some of our expertise and our experiences in theirs as well, you never go wrong by bringing, you know, strong folks into your fold and helping garner information from them and decisions. So I think Mr. Cleveland, to Dr. Cleveland, you most of you have been in the interim state superintendent of Curtech, you know, for a while. Deputy state superintendent of Curtech, he's a very respected guy.
And if we've got him this close by, we can tap him. That's good.
He's not on our papers.
No, that's even better.
That's right.
Okay. Anything else, y'all? Any questions? Anything else you wanna cover? DEA, it's good to see you today. Have any issues we need to?
Oh, I just wanted to give you, since we met last, myself and Teresa, she's not here today, we went to a leadership conference in Mobile. Sheila was one of the presenters there. And David was installed as our state vice president, and Laura Hill was installed on the board. So we have a lot of representation at the state level from our district. And we just got back from Boston, the NEA assembly. And unless I'm mistaken, it's the largest meeting of Robert's Rules of Order that they have. We had 7,000 delegates, 3,000 others. So it's interesting to see 5 and 6 versus 7,000. It's something to see. It's really interesting. But myself and Teresa and David Holt and Cindy Black, we all went representing DeKalb County. And Nancy Wilson and Anita Gibson are retirees that represent our county. So other than Madison County and Mobile County, I think we have more people there county-wise. So just to give you an idea that we attend our meetings and our trainings, and we to keep up to date with things, so I just wanted to give you an update, and that's all that I have.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for what you do.